everybody. How are we doing? Little update on our Christmas tickets. This morning we had about 700 sold. Actually, as of tonight, we are down to our last 230 tickets or so. So they really are going fast, and we will sell out that venue probably this week. And so we really don't want anyone to miss out. And so just can I encourage you to get not only your tickets, but the tickets of people that you are bringing with you really, really soon. How about just standing to your feet? It'd be great just to pray before we go to the Word for a few minutes. We've been in a series, if you don't know already, called Let's Go. Turn to your neighbor and say, let's go. We've been talking about the Great Commission. We've been talking about going out into all the world and doing what we've been called to do. And tonight, I'm going to finish off this series with a message that I just woke up on Wednesday morning, and I just felt God just put this phrase in my heart, and I really believe tonight God's going to do something amazing. Amen. Amen. So maybe you've got expectation. We're just going to pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the example of Jesus. We thank you for the great mission that we have been commissioned to be part of. Thank you, Lord, that we're not here to make up the numbers. We're not here to watch from the stands. But God, we are invited to play in the amazing game, Father. And today we want to take our place. We want to position ourselves for all that you have for us. And so, God, right now we just say, Lord, we are ready to go. We are ready to go. We're not holding back. We are ready to go and to be the people you've called us to be. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. And just one more thing, Father, we pray for the England football team tonight. Let them not disappoint us one more time. Because we want to beat France in a few days' time, because Samuel van der Hagen drove in here with a French flag this morning. And I just really want to beat them, Jesus. If you can help us, that would be amazing. Amen! Amen. You can grab a seat, okay. Very good, very good. Well, we like to have fun in church. Don't accuse me of being sacrilegious. I'm only joking. Tonight, I just want to read a couple of powerful scriptures to you before I give you the theme of what I want to talk about tonight. Isaiah chapter 42 says this. Isaiah 42, verse 6 and 7. Really amazing, amazing words. It says, I, the Lord, have called you to demonstrate my righteousness. And I will take you by the hand and guard you. And I will give you to my people Israel as a symbol of my covenant with them. Listen to this. And you will be a light to guide the nations, and you will open the eyes of the blind. You will open the eyes of the blind. And you will free the captives from prison, releasing those who sit in dark dungeons. What an amazing prophetic promise from the book of Isaiah. Like I said, we are not called to make up the numbers on this planet. We have a mission. We have a purpose. And part of it is right here, that God wants to speak through us and use us to open the eyes of the blind. Interesting that Jesus, in all his miracles on the earth, when it came to healing, he healed more blind eyes than he did any other disease. And I believe that's a picture for us today that, maybe not physically blind, but many people not seeing the truth of God's word and his truth. You will free the captives from prison. Amen. And you will release those who sit in dark dungeons. Isn't that a crazy thought? There are people today who are sitting metaphorically in dark dungeons. And we have the truth of the gospel. We have the answers. We have the keys. We know what it is to be able to set people free, and God is wanting us to do it. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4 to 5 says this, powerful scripture, Satan, who is the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. He has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They are unable to see the glorious light of the good news They don't understand this message about the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. And so again, just this idea that there are people in this earth that they can't see what we see. And our job is to actually address that issue and go to the root of it so that people can see what we see. Tonight, I want to talk to you about, and I'm in a way, I couldn't think of a better title, and so you might come up with something better, but I want to talk to you about how to pray for the lost. I want to talk to you about how to pray for those people who are dear to us but are far from God. Those people right now who are living in darkness, those people right now who have blind eyes, who maybe have heard the truth of the gospel but cannot perceive it, cannot receive it. I've got people in my world that I've been praying for over 20 years. So I'm not saying this is an instantaneous prayer. I'm not saying that things are going to instantly change, although some will. But there may be some people that we need to pray for a long period of time. And I want to start off by saying this. Every one of us is a believer today because someone, somewhere, prayed for you and prayed for me. Someone, somewhere, prayed for you, prayed for me, and that is why we came to a revelation of Jesus. I'm so grateful for a godly parents, a godly mom, godly dad, who prayed for us as kids, who continue to pray for their grandchildren, who pray for my kids, praying that they would come to a revelation of Christ. Because the reality is we needed a little help. We actually need a little help when it comes to recognizing God in our lives. You came to Christ because somebody somewhere prayed for you. I don't have time right now, but I could ask Neil Harvey to come up here and share his testimony, and he'll tell you that in the moment of despair of his life, the lowest moment, someone was praying for him. I love what Joyce Meyer says. She says, when we pray over someone, it creates a window of opportunity for God to move in their lives at that moment. And so when we pray, say amen, come on, let's clap. Something happens in that moment. Someone prayed for you. It might have been a godly mother or a father. It might have been a friend. It might have been a pastor. It might have been a Sunday school teacher, a youth pastor, a missionary, a fellow student, a co-worker. But someone, somewhere, cared enough to pray for you. And so if someone did that for us, how many of you know it is incumbent upon us that we do it for others? That we are praying for people to see the light, and so here's the thing, you know, when it comes to miracles, how many of you know you need to pray to see a miracle? You need to pray to see a miracle. If you want to see the miracle of healing, you better pray. If you want to see the miracle of provision, you better pray. And we need to understand this, that salvation is the greatest miracle that has ever been or ever will be. If you're here tonight and you say, I don't know if miracles still happen, you are a miracle. The miracle of salvation is the greatest miracle that will ever happen to you. You could get a breakthrough tomorrow, a healing tomorrow, somebody could give you a house tomorrow, something phenomenal could happen, but you have already experienced the greatest miracle you'll ever experience, the miracle of salvation. That's the greatest miracle. How could the miracle of salvation happen without prayer? For the miracle of salvation to happen in someone's life, there has got to be prayer, amen? Now, here's the thing. If God wants someone saved, here's what he does. He places a burden on someone's heart to pray for that person. Are you with me? When he says, man, I want that person saved, I want to draw that person, he places a prayer burden on their heart that they would be drawn close to God. I've got people right now that I am burdened for to come to faith in Jesus. I'm burdened by them. Barely a week goes by where I'm not praying for these people that God has placed a burden. Here's the thing. I am not the initiator of the burden. God is the initiator of the burden. God's like, man, I want that person, I want that man, I want that woman in my kingdom. And so he comes to you and me and he places a burden on our hearts and he says, would you pray? Would you pray for that person? Let me just read a really great story. Many of you will know of a man called George Muller. George Muller of Bristol, England, was known as a man of prayer, without ever asking for funds and living entirely by faith in God, he established 5 orphanages in Bristol that provided care for 10,000 orphans over a 60-year period. His journals record in minute detail how God directly answered thousands of his prayers. Towards the end of his life, he remarked that he had prayed for 2 men to be saved for over 55 years. Somebody asked him, "Don't you feel like giving up?" And he replied, "Oh no. Why would God give me such a burden for these men if he did not intend to save them?" Before his death, one of the men came to Christ. The other one was saved after he died. But the point is this, because a true prayer burden comes from the Lord and not from us, we can believe that if God burdens us to pray for a certain person or a group of people, it is because he intends to work a miracle of his saving grace. Can I get an amen in the house tonight? If God burdens you to pray, it's because he wants to do something. It's not to frustrate you. It's not to pull it out for years and years. It's because he wants to do something. And so when you receive a burden to pray for your neighbor, your work colleague, your family member, your mom, your dad, your nephew, your niece, whoever it might be encouraged, even though it may not happen quickly. It is the intention of God to bring that person to faith. You and I, it's not our job to bring them to faith. It's our job to pray for them. It's our job to pray for them, amen? And God will do something pretty cool. So listen, here's a little thought you might want to write down. When it comes to our friends, when it comes to the people we're trying to win to the Lord, I like this statement. We need to talk to God about people before we talk to people about God. I wish I came up with that. I didn't. If I say it a few more times, I'll pretend it's mine. We need to talk to God about people before we talk to people about God. You know, oftentimes we just want to rush in and we want to tell people about God. We want to tell people about salvation. But actually, what we need to do is we need to back up a little bit and we need to pray over people so that actually there would be a receptiveness in their heart to receive what we're saying. Are you with me? We need to do our homework. Now you say, why is that? Why do I need to pray for people first? And the answer is because of the condition that people are actually in life. Now, this might shock you a little bit tonight, but what I'm about to say is entirely biblical, and I could give you scriptures for every one of these things, and I don't want to do that because it would just be too long. But here's the condition of where people are at that don't know God. They are blind. They are blind, but they think they can see. They are captive, but they think they are free. They are condemned, but they think they are justified. The Bible says they are dead in their sin and their trespasses, but they think they are living. They are helpless, but they think they are in control. They are hopeless, but they think they have hope. Now, I want you to hear me tonight. I say this with no judgment. I say this with no condemnation. I say this to simply help us understand when we see a person that is not walking with the Lord, all of those things are true, according to Scripture. All of those things are true. And so if we're going to see a shift in people's lives, if we're going to see something happen, we better pray. We better pray before we start telling people about what they need to change in their world, because they're blind, but they think they can see. They're captive, but they think they're free. They're condemned, but they think they're walking justified. They're dead, but they're living. Listen, this is a horrible illustration, I'm really sorry. But for a moment, if I was to put a dead body on the stage, if I was to put a dead body on the stage, how many of you I can talk to that body, I can speak to that body, I can command that body, I can shout at that body, but that body cannot hear, it cannot feel, it cannot think, it cannot process, it cannot receive what I'm saying because it is dead. The Bible says before we came to faith in Jesus Christ, in our spirits, we were dead. Are you with me? And so when we start preaching to people without first addressing their condition, they can't oftentimes receive what we're saying. Some of us are trying to persuade people's opinion, persuade people through our clever articulation. But I want to tell you, we got to go back to basics. And when it comes to our friends who don't know Jesus, we need to go back to the place of prayer. Can I get an amen? Let me remind you what 2 Corinthians says. Satan, who is the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. That he's blinded them. And so we've got to address the fact that their eyes have been blinded before they can receive what we're trying to give them. Is this making sense tonight? So I want to give you a little acronym on how to pray. Is that okay? How to pray. And I want to use the acronym HEART, H-E-A-R-T. And I'm sure as all of you know, that's easy to remember because it's the same acronym as our heart values. So you're gonna remember this. You can go away. You could memorize this, I reckon, in about 2 minutes. If you went through this once or twice, you would actually remember how to pray. Let me give you the overview, and then quickly we'll go through some scriptures. Number one, we want to pray for receptive hearts. We want to pray for receptive hearts. Number two, we want to pray that spiritual eyes would be opened. Spiritual eyes would be opened. Number three, we want to pray that there would be an awareness to God's attitude to sin. There'll be an awakening, an understanding of how God views it. Number four, we can pray that they would be released to trust Jesus. And number five, we want to pray that there would be a transformed life. Amen. I'm going to get out of the way so you can take a photo of that. If you don't want me in the photo, I'm sure. So there you go. If you wanted a fresh photo without me in it, you can take it. There you go. All right. All right, let me give you some scriptures tonight, and then I'm going to give you a story, and my goodness, we're going to pray tonight, and I believe something's going to happen. Number one, we want to pray for receptive hearts. When it comes to our friends and our families and our classmates and our work colleagues, we want to pray, Lord, would you make their hearts receptive to the gospel of Jesus? Proverbs 21, verse 1 says this, the king's heart is like a stream of water directed by the Lord. He guides it wherever he pleases. The king's heart is like a stream of water directed by the Lord. He guides it wherever he pleases. I love that thought. A person's heart in the hands of God is able to be directed wherever God chooses for it to go. Now, understand this. This is not God manipulating people. This is not God coercing people, but just recognizing that the God of the universe is able to gently influence a person's heart to become more and more open to the gospel. Amen. We got to be praying over people. God, would you make their hearts receptive? Come on, I got some friends that I've journeyed with for a while, and their hearts in seasons have been very unreceptive. Their hearts have been hardened. That walls have gone up. And so I've started to say, God, would you just open their hearts? I can't do it, Lord, but you can. God, would you open their hearts? Would you soften their hearts? Would you bring the walls down so that there may be a possibility of them seeing what they've never seen before? Amen? The second thing we can pray is that spiritual eyes would be open. Spiritual eyes would be open. Acts 26, verse 17 says this, and I will rescue you from both your own people and the Gentiles. Yes, I am sending you to the Gentiles to open their eyes so they may turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God. Then they will receive forgiveness for their sins. And I love this next part. What a great promise. And they will be given a place amongst God's people. Isn't that cool? God says, I'm sending you. That's you and me. He says, I'm sending you to the people that their eyes would be opened so that they could receive from God and be given a place among God's people. One of the prayers we got to pray, we got to say, God, would you open their eyes to see? Would you open their eyes to see? Right now, the enemy, the Bible says, the God of this age has blinded the eyes of so many people. They're blinded. I mean, you think about it for a moment, you shut your eyes and you can't see. That's a horrible thing. But you and I, through the power of our prayer, have the ability to start to see blind eyes open. Come on, when you see your friends and your family and your loved ones that are not walking with God, you don't need to be disheartened. You don't have to give up. Or you just need to know that you have a direct relationship with the God of the universe, who is able to go into their world and to open their eyes so that they could see what they've never seen before. Amen. Come on, blind eyes open. Blind eyes open. We can start to declare that over our friends, declare that over our family. God, I declare blind eyes are opening in this next season. I declare it. God, I'm declaring over my family, my friends, my loved ones. They may not see right now, but Lord, you are going and you are opening their eyes to see the truth. Come on, that's a good faith declaration right there, isn't it? And we can pray spiritual eyes. Here's the third one. We want to pray that people would come to a revelation of God's attitude towards sin. Now, I know that we don't talk about the word sin a whole lot. We probably say other things in its place. But what is sin? Sin is simply missing the mark. That's all sin is. Sin is falling lower than the standard that God has set. But the problem with sin is sin creates a rupture in the relationship between us and God. In fact, the only way to have a relationship with God is for that relationship to be mended, and we know that the only person who was able to do that was Jesus Christ himself. So praise God, sin for us is nothing to be afraid of. The Bible says that for you and I, our past sins, our present sins, and our future sins, every one of them has already been forgiven. Can I get an amen? All our sins have already been forgiven for all of eternity. Whatever we do, God has forgiven them. But yet, we need to understand that sin is an issue when it comes to our relationship with God. Here's what it says in John 16, verse 8. And when he comes, speaking about Jesus, he will convict the world of its sin. In other words, he will make them aware. There's an issue here that needs to be dealt with. He will convict the world of its sin and of God's righteousness and of the coming judgment. And so one of the things we can pray over our friends is listen, we're not here to condemn anybody. But when it comes to sin, we can just say, God, would you just make my family member, my friend, my loved one, my work colleague, Lord, could they wake up one day and there could there be conviction on the inside that the way they're living or what they're into or what they're dealing with is actually rupturing their relationship with an eternal and a good God? It's like if you knew that there was something you were doing was breaking a relationship with your own natural parents, your own natural family, if you knew that, you would want to do something about it, wouldn't you? And so we're just praying the same thing. We're saying, God, when it comes to our friends and family, could you just make them aware that there's an issue here that they don't even know is an issue? Most people are going through life and they just think everything's fine, everything's good. And all we're praying is, God, let them become a growing awareness. Let them become a revelation that there's a problem here that needs to be dealt with. Now, here's the fourth one, and I love this one. We want to pray that people would be released to trust Jesus. Amen. Isaiah 61, verse 1 says this, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, for the Lord, this is talking about Jesus, has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to comfort the brokenhearted and, I love this, to proclaim that captives will be released and prisoners will be freed. That's pretty good, isn't it? Let me read it again. He has sent me to comfort the brokenhearted and to proclaim that captives will be released and prisoners will be free. So how are we going to pray over our loved ones, those who are far from God? We say, God, we pray for receptive hearts. God, we pray for eyes to open. God, we pray for a growing revelation that something is not right in my life. And then fourthly, we can say, God, I'm declaring over this brother, over this sister, over this family, I'm declaring that, Lord, in 2023, some people are going to be set free from captivity that they are living in right now. They'll be released. They don't know they're bound, but we know they are. We know Scripture teaches us that. So when it comes to our prayer, man, we start to boldly declare captives being set free, amen? People breaking out of jail. Come on, can you remember the moment when you found freedom in God? Can you remember a moment when you were like, man, I was bound up, but now I'm free? We want that for our world, don't we? We want that for those people who are walking with us. And then here's the fifth thing that we can be praying. And remember, this is such a simple thing, H-E-A-R-T. We want to pray for transformed lives. Nothing less. Nothing less than transformed lives, amen. We're not praying for slightly adjusted lives. We're not praying for slightly better behavior. We're not praying for behavior modification. We are praying for transformed lives in Jesus' name. 2 Corinthians 5 verse 17 says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone and a new life has begun. Amen. Come on, when it comes to my family and my friends and the people in my world, I'm not praying for behavior modification. I'm not praying for a slight adjustment in how they live life. I'm saying, Lord, I want them to walk into a brand new life in you. A transformed life. A transformed life. H-E-A-R-T, you can remember that, can't you? You can remember that. We got to pray. Listen, I love the thing Steve shared, B-E-S-T, best strategy. We're going to bless people. We're going to pray. We're going to eat. We're going to show. We're going to tell. But I do love the fact that it doesn't start with tell. I love the fact that it starts with prayer. Starts with prayer. Come on, tonight I pray you pick up a prayer burden. I pray you pick up a prayer burden for your friends, your family. I pray the Holy Spirit would burden you tonight. I pray you'd leave this place burdened for people in your world that right now don't know Jesus. We need to pray. In 2 weeks' time, we'll gather in GLive and we'll have in excess of 1,000 people in the room. We will have hundreds of people who don't know Jesus. Hundreds. Hundreds. And here's the reality. We can put on a good show. We can ask for the anointing to turn up, it will. We can do everything in the natural right. But if we have not prayed, if we have not prayed, then spiritual eyes won't open. Captives won't be set free. People in bondage won't find freedom. I don't do this very often, but I'm imploring us, Equippers Church. I'm imploring us in the next 2 weeks that we pray for this service. I'm imploring us. We pray every week. 8 a.m., Tuesday morning, you can join us on Zoom. you can't make that, Wednesday night, we'll be praying. If you can't make that, pray in your connect groups. If you can't make that, gather your family, gather your friends, pray. Because we could spend all that money, put all that time, put all that energy in, do something that people clap at and wow at and cheer at and say, you guys are amazing. But if blind eyes don't open, if captive aren't set free, if people don't get conviction of where they're living in their life, all we have done is put on another great Christmas show that changed nothing. And so I'm saying, Equippers Church, come on, I'm imploring us. I pray you hear my heart tonight. Could we pick up a burden? Woo! Could we pick up a burden for the people in our world? It's not going to shift if we don't pray. I don't care how good these guys are on the stage. I don't care how good I preached that night. If we have not prayed, nothing's going to happen. And we need God to turn up, amen? We need Him to turn up. I want to read you this final story, and then we're going to pray tonight, and I believe God's going to do something great. I'm just going to read this to you. It goes like this. One of my favorite stories about the power of prayer to win the lost is over 1,600 years old. It begins with a woman named Monica who was raised by Christian parents in North Africa. When she was old enough, her parents arranged a marriage to a pagan man. That just means somebody who was not going on with God, somebody who was living a very natural life rather than a spiritual life. Evidently, the marriage was very difficult because of the divided spiritual loyalties. Monica and her husband had three children who survived. Two of them followed Christ, but one son left the faith of his childhood. By his own admission, he chose the path of worldly pleasure. For many years, he lived with a mistress, and together they gave birth to a son out of wedlock. He broke his mother's heart by joining a religious cult. Monica prayed for 17 years that her son would return to Christ and to the church. And looking back, her son said that she watered the earth with her tears for him, praying more for his spiritual death than most mothers pray over the physical death of a child. She fasted and she prayed and she asked God to save her son. One day she went to see the bishop, and with tears, she asked why her son was still living in sin. The bishop replied with words that have become famous across the centuries. He said, "It is not possible that the son of so many tears should perish. Your son will be saved." He was right. It took several more years of fervent praying, but eventually Monica's son came to Christ. His name is Augustine. He is universally regarded as one of the greatest thinkers in Christian history. 16 centuries later, his books and writings are still in print. He makes it clear in his confessions, listen to this, that his mother prayed him to Jesus. St. Augustine said this, she would not give up, and eventually God answered her prayers. Oh, don't you love that? One of the greatest theologians of thousands of years was far from God, but had a mother that relentlessly and consistently prayed. Listen, we are here today because people have prayed over us. It's our turn, church. It's our time to start to pray. It's our time to start to reach out for those who are far from God, and with tears in our own eyes, reach out and say, God, would you do for them what you've done for us? Would you break open blind eyes? Would you let people see what's happening? And I love that phrase. Come on, anyone here today says, I'm willing to pray them to Jesus. I'm willing to pray them to Jesus. I love that. Come on, right now, you got someone in your world. You're going to pray them to Jesus. Might take longer than you hope. We're going to pray them to Jesus. Might happen quickly. Wonderful. We're going to pray them to Jesus. Amen. How about standing to your feet? Give me a wave right now if you've got someone in your world you've been praying for. Come on. Someone you've been like, man, I'm going after them. I've been I've been lifting them up. I'm so hungry to see them come to know the Lord. Come on, tonight, I really believe God put it on my heart. If we would join together as a group of people, I know it's Sunday night church, but man, we're just going to have a Holy Ghost prayer meeting for a few moments, if that's okay. Because I really believe that something is going to happen outside of this room as we pray in this room. Could I just have those five things up on the screen, guys? The H-E-A-R-T. That would be awesome just to help us in our praying for a moment. How about just lifting your hands? It's the presence of God. You can just feel just a burden coming upon people's hearts. But if that's you and you say, oh, man, I'm willing to be burdened for the lost. I'm willing to be burdened for those who are dear to me but are far from God. Come on, just say, Holy Spirit, you can lay it on my heart tonight. You can lay it on my heart tonight. Come on, we're just going to worship for a moment and then we're going to pray.